We are now into a very important area, activity-based costing. Many of you, in fact, perhaps all of you have come across this before in your studies, but I'm hoping to do much more than what you have done in your studies and ultimately make you confident enough to do a small ABC exercise in your own companies. Okay? So that's my objective in this area. Okay, so we've already made the case of why we want ABC, because of complexity. Then many costs are not based on volume, but other things such as complexity. In a modern multi-product firm, it recognizes that costs are incurred by undertaking activities such as setting up a machine, scheduling production, ordering raw materials, finding a new vendor, which is called search costs, developing a new product, R&D, marketing, research, etc., making a quality inspection. You can see that all of these are not related to output volume. For example, the first one, you can set up a machine to make one unit or 1,000 units. Okay, but the cost is not related to the volume. So these costs are more related to factors other than output volume. Examples of non-volume factors that drive costs would be how many parts and products the company handles, how many customer orders it processes. These are factors that reflect the complexity of a modern company. So complexity exists in various forms. The range of products, the number of customers, markets, and distribution channels, the frequency of product introductions, the variants available of each product, which is the customization possible of a variety, the frequency of changeovers in the production process setup. So we've come across these already now. We've talked about these days mass customization. We've talked about setups that took 4 to 8 hours, been done in 3 minutes. Okay, we talked about various the companies having to introduce their products in a faster cycle. I've talked about Lexus that introduces product every 5 years, when Mercedes-Benz is taking 7 years. Okay, so these are all things that are happening today that increases complexity. So what is the response to the challenge of complexity? Well, once again, I've already mentioned that the traditional accounting systems cannot cope with this complexity. Okay, it's tried to do a little bit of things such as increase the number of allocations or even change the percentage rates in the second stage allocation, but ultimately they still deal with output volume. Various methods have been tried by companies. The creation of more bases consists in the first stage, using different percentage rates to vary cost burdens in the second stage. So they may say, look, we know that the black pen takes less time than the red pen, so let us take some percentage of cost from here and put it there, but why 10%, why not 15%, like that? Okay, it's become very subjective. So these things don't work. Fundamentally, however, all these methods ultimately use output volume allocations. Thus, they can never reflect the true cause and effect of costs in modern firms. Thus, the need arises to re-engineer cost analysis and control systems to deal with complexity costs. Okay, so this is where ABC comes in. Now, we've made the whole of yesterday and even under benchmark, we've made the case why we need this. So let's look at what exactly is activity-based costing. It's actually a model of cost allocation. Now, when I say model, it's like a map. Okay, you have a map of Dubai. It tells you that you start from point A and turn left, turn right, and you go to point B. So a cost model, this is in fact a cost model. It says that you start with this cost document, you go to this natural account, you get allocated to this, you turn left, turn right, and you end up in this product cost. Okay? So that is essentially a cost model. The basic idea in cost modeling is you tie the cost to the objects that are causing them. This is the cause-effect relationship. Thus, ideally a product that actually consumes a large quantity of resources should be reported as expensive to produce. So let's look at that. So we have resources used, low and high, and reported cost. Low and high. So if you have a product that uses a low amount of resources, so what are these resources? Yesterday you used, paper, you used staples, you used your own labor, you used the lighting and the table, and you used the scissors and so on. Those are the resources that you used. Now for product C, if you used a low amount of resources, you could do it very fast, you could do it with less paper, okay, one staple. Well, if you use a low amount of resources and your costing system said that you're using a low amount of resources, then you have a good costing system. If, on the other hand, for product B, that took a lot more time to do it correctly, make sure that the paper is not folded, you use a high amount of resources, and your costing system reported that the costs were high, again, you have a good costing system. But if your costing system, because of these inaccurate cost allocations, showed you that even though you used a low amount of resources, it's telling you that the cost is very high, you have a problem. Similarly, over here, you use a low amount of, high amount of resources, but the costing system allocates that incorrectly. What did you have? Saying it's a reported low cost, you have a problem. So this really is the summarization of the course. We really need to make sure that you report accurately. You're using resources for a product or service, the reported cost should reflect that. Okay, so ABC is actually pretty simple. Four general terms are used: objects, resources, activities, and cost drivers. So I will be writing this over here. Okay, that's all you have to remember. Cost object. What are we costing? Okay, resources used. Resources used, activities, and cost drivers. Four things. So objects are essentially the targets of cost calculation. So what are we costing? Remember when we looked yesterday at our cost specification, we said cost object is what are we costing? So are we costing a cost of a product, cost of a service, cost of a market, cost of a customer group? What are we costing? Resources, what is used to perform work that gives rise to costs? Personnel, computer systems, machinery, labor, overhead, these are all resources. Activities, the sort of work the resources perform. Setting up a machine, ordering raw materials, bookkeeping, making investment budget, advertising a product, designing a computer system, etc. So yesterday, what are the activities that you did in your simulation game? You did cutting, stapling, marketing, all of that was done. These are the activities that you perform. And the cost drivers, the last one. How do you link the activity and the resource to the cost object? Where is the link? Sometimes you may find that there is no link, in fact. These are means by which the activities are characterized and are linked to the cost object being costed. The number of setups, the number of manufacturing orders. So yesterday, in your hole puncher, you could link the hole puncher resource cost to the number of holes in each product. Now you can find a link. In other cases, it may be more difficult to find that link. Okay, so cost drive, the link. Okay, so in the first step in ABC analysis, now as I told you, I want to get you all to try a simple ABC exercise. Two things are done in parallel: defining the cost drivers and finding the activities. The result of the above depend very much on the judgment of the ABC system designer. The factor that influence the choice of activity and cost drivers are the purpose of the project. the accuracy required, and the availability of data. Now, I have walked into a company, a big company, British American Tobacco, and I have done an ABC exercise in one afternoon. Okay, one afternoon. Why? Because I was not doing a project for the whole company. I was doing a simple exercise to show management that they should hire me as a consultant to do the actual project. So I took two of their products, which I knew was a high volume and low volume product, and I showed them how costs change, okay, by using information that was given, very ad hoc information by management. Okay, so it depends on the purpose of the project and the accuracy required as well. So when you're identifying activities and drivers, especially when you're talking about people, you have to do interviews. In order to do this, one must interview managers, supervisors, and other employees, either individually or in related groupings. So each person or group interviewed define a set of activities and the time the person spends on each activity. Each activity then classified as related to one or more of the defined cost drivers. This last step is normally a very difficult step that requires a thorough understanding of each activity. So let's look at an example now, handling of a forklift. Okay, so here is my drawing of a forklift. The forklift driving it, okay. Now that is a forklift, but I'm not going to look at the machine, I'm going to look at the person who is driving it. Okay, the person who is driving it. Let us say the driver, the forklift driver, that is the actual driver, not the cost driver, okay, we are giving him $100,000 with overtime for that job. This person has to go to a warehouse. Let us say he goes to warehouse number 2 first, gets some product and goes to the production floor and deposits it there. Then after that he goes to warehouse number 1, get some product and comes and puts it there and so on. Okay, so the cost object, let us say, is products, that there are 3 products, A, B, and C. The resources used is the salary of the forklift truck driver, we know is $100,000. The activity is driving forklift. Okay, so now we have to find the cost driver. So here is the 3 products, A, B, and C. How do we allocate this to these 3 products? So what you will do is, you will go into here and ask yourself the question, why did the forklift truck driver go first to warehouse 2 and then to warehouse 1 and so on? Why did he do that? Any idea? No, why did he move like that? Yes?
Because the workflow is a process, require material from warehouse 1 first, then warehouse
2. So why didn't he go to warehouse 1 first? Why did he go to warehouse 2 first?
Because the component of workflow of the process.
How does he know that? He's just a driver. He doesn't know the flow of components.
Position.
He's just an ordinary driver. Yes?
He may have got requisition from the truck.
Okay, yeah, we're getting close now. So he was given some sort of order. Okay? Now this order can be just verbal. Hey John, can you go to warehouse 2, pick up material for product A and take it to the, could be a verbal order. Okay, if it's a verbal order, we can't keep track of it. But most likely it will be some sort of work order from a requisition or something. Okay, so he will be told, look, first job you have to do is to pick up from warehouse 2 material for product A and deposit it. Next job you can go to warehouse 1. So you have a work order. So let us say that there are 1,000 work orders. 1,000 work orders for the year. 500 of these for A, pertaining to A, 300 for B, and 200 for C. So that is how they would do it. So 100,000 divided by 1,000 is $100 a work order. So $100 times 500, product A will get 50,000 of the driver's time. Okay, so that is one method. Now, is there any problem with that? Are you all happy with using work orders as a cost driver? Not happy. Okay, why?
Because the time spent is...
Okay, what do you mean by that? Time spent? Yes, warehouse 2 might be very far away. Okay, warehouse 1 might be closer. Warehouse 2 might require you to spend a lot of time because it's a very, very heavy item. Warehouse other one for product B might be less weightage. You can do 2 or 3 work orders in one run, while for the other component, you may need 2 runs to do 1 work order. So we are having a few problems there. Okay, now my suggestion is don't get too complicated. Okay. Remember, we are moving from a single cost driver to a more. We don't have to get auditor level accuracy. Don't get too complicated. So all I might do is to say, okay, each work order, a work order, has, say, it tells you what the product is. So let's say product A, pick up this component, this component, this component, and this component. So I will count the work order lines. So rather than work orders, let us say that in the year there are 1,000 work order lines, indicate that every line is a move. So then let us say there was 6,000 work order lines pertaining to A, 2,000 pertaining to B, and 2,000 pertaining to C. Okay, so instead of the work order, I take a work order line. I may not go beyond that. Okay? So don't have an auditor mentality. Auditors try to go to the 10th decimal place, but they get the first number wrong. Okay? We are going to have quick and dirty, but more sort of better information that is given to you faster and easier. So normally a move by a forklift is initialized every time a manufacturing order is released. Thus the number of drivers could be assumed to be the number of manufacturing orders. If a particular manufacturing order is large, it could result in several moves of the forklift. Thus material volume could be the cost driver, or work order lines could be a cost driver. The point I'm going to make is the solution is a compromise. Do not try to be too sophisticated. Keep it simple. Okay? So that is in terms of the person. Right. Next example is the machine. Now we can use the forklift itself as the machine, and you'll find often that if the forklift is moving everywhere that the person is moving, the cost driver would often be the same. Right? But let's look at a different machine. One that doesn't involve a person. Taking a machine from my favorite industry, and that's telecommunication. Okay, now, I don't know about how they do it in Dubai, but in Australia, if you find in your road a house that is doesn't seem occupied, is often closed up, and you can't see anyone there, that most likely could be your telephone company's telephone exchange. Okay, the telephone exchange for the area. Okay, so telephone exchange is the machine. Okay, so we have to do this again now. Okay, so first of all, let's look at the activity. What does the telephone exchange do? We're diverting in a certain way. Yes? Very good, but what's the technical term for that? Call coming in and call going out. So from call origination to call completion, it is called switching. Okay, so basically, if you remember the old Hollywood movies, where the telephone operator takes a plug here and puts a plug there, that is what this is doing electronically. It is getting a call origination and doing a call completion, switching. Okay, and it's doing it extremely fast electronically. So that is the activity. Now let us use the resource. So the telephone exchange, let us say, cost us $10 million. Now these are only indicative, okay, for example, not accurate. It costs us $10 million to purchase it, install it, including the house, $10 million. Okay, so what is the resource cost? Think before you answer. We bought the telephone exchange for $10 million, including the house and installation charge.
Depreciation.
Sorry?
Depreciation.
Very good, excellent. So it's not $10 million. But depreciation. So we have to divide this by the life of the telephone exchange. So let us say the life is 10 years. So it is $1 million depreciation. That is our resource cost. Okay. Now this is the same for all machinery. So it's very easy. You don't have to do interviews and so on. Okay, very easy. Okay. Cost driver. The cost driver would be the number of switches, number of times it goes switching. So cost driver, number of switches. Now we have one more thing, cost object. Okay, so what is the principal cost object of a telephone company? Now of course there can be many cost objects. Okay, I told you division or factory, but the principal one is the cost object from which the company makes money.
Sales.
Sales, yes, I need more information. Remember in the simulation when you had product A, B, and C, in the telephone company, what would those be?
Calls,
time.
Sorry?
Calls,
telephone calls, yes, but I need more information.
Time,
correct, but more information. Yes, time duration. Okay, now here is a little secret. If you go into any company as a consultant and you want to know its principal cost object, the one it makes money from, easiest way is to look at the invoice. Okay, so what would you find on a telephone company's invoice? Now all of you have got a telephone bill. So what do you find in there? Rental, yes, yeah. But rental is not pertaining to telephone exchange because that has nothing to do with the rental. Okay, we are getting closer now. Come on. Huh? Yeah, but think about your telephone bill. What does it have? What does the package consist of? Are you really serious that you look at number of minutes? I don't know, the Dubai telephone bill may be different from Australian, but I don't think so. What do you have in a telephone bill? Think about your telephone bill.
Call time.
Yeah, that is the rental, that's, sorry?
Call time.
Destination, thank you. So what is that called in the telephone language? Local calls? Isn't that what you find in your telephone bill? Okay, too rich, Yola. You don't even look at your telephone bill. Okay, so you have local calls.
You see WhatsApp.
Okay, you have STD, now that is not sexually transmitted disease, but subscriber trunk dialing, okay? And we have IDD, which is international direct dialing, and we have mobile, okay? And other things like internet and so on. So, this is what you find on your telephone bill. So that's the secret, look at your bill. So let us say that you find, in fact, that there were, let us say, 100 million switches and 30 million local, 10 million long distance, 1 million, let's say another 10 million international, and 50 million mobile, that is starting with a mobile and ending in a landline or something. So you can now allocate. Okay, so that is the cost of it. Okay, now let's do another example. An airline, not airport this time, an airline. What is the main cost object of an airline?
Fuel.
I told you the secret is to look at its invoice. So what is the invoice of an airline company called?
The fare.
It's not called the fare, what is it called? Air ticket.
Yes.
Okay. So what does your air ticket have? Yes, there is a bit of that. Okay. So tell me more information, please. I heard the word.
Destination
is one. Anything else? Like the local call?
Class.
Ticket does not.
Class.
Your air ticket is business class, first class, economy. Okay, even that you know there are different A and B's and Y's and all sorts of things, right? So it is this route, time, class. Okay, those are the things. So that would be your invoice. So that, like that, as I told you, think about the industry and how it collects money as your main cost object. Okay. Let's look at aircraft maintenance group. How do you collect your money? Contract, long-term contracts?
The maintenance score, it is component.
Okay. Okay, good. So your contract would have the different types of what you're doing for the engine, for the components, all of that. So that is your cost objects. Okay, so you can see, I can ask the question for anyone. Insurance company, the type of policies, and the various classes of those policies, and the duration, and so on. Okay, so that's the secret. Look at the invoice to find the principal cost objects. Okay, so as I told you, not all costs are related to human activities. The human activity will be defined by the interviews. Substantial costs are non-human, such as electricity, depreciation, rent, and so on. These are usually classified by cost drivers directly, determining the cost of the most logical cost driver. Very easy. Okay. It's the humans that cause problems because you have to interview them. These other things, very easy to find the cost driver. And often, it's not even an indirect cost, it's a direct cost. Now, some of you who are in the telephone industry would know that these days, in the case of a telephone exchange, every single switch, duct, cable is dedicated. There are switches that only do local calls, switches that only do international calls, switches that only do long distance calls. So it's almost direct cost, not shared cost. Okay. So it's quite easy when it comes to machinery. Another problem, of course, is that not all costs can be logically assigned to all cost objects. For example, advertising costs may not be causally assigned to a particular product. So let's look at that situation. Okay, so here is an advertisement in the Gulf News, which is Y centimeters by X centimeters. You're advertising, let us say, some sort of mobile phone at a great price. And the cost of that advertisement is $1,000. Now this is straightforward advertising cost, can be a direct cost to this product, no allocation required, right? But you can take the same advertisement size, same Y centimeters by X centimeters, which is going to cost us $1,000, but in this one, you can do all the different products that you have, all the different products you have with the company's logo. So now, how do you allocate this 1,000 to these products? Any ideas? Area. Now that makes sense, area. Because after all, you're paying for area. So how much of area do these pictures take? Sounds logical. Come to that in a minute. Okay, so let's look at area. But not a very good idea. Why? This can be a big picture of a ping pong ball, and that's a little picture of a Mercedes Benz. Right? So we can't use area. So what most marketers use is percentage turnover, as you just mentioned. So they will take their revenue of this, divide the advertising cost by the revenue, total revenues of all of them, and multiply by individual revenue. Now, yes?
Question. That means any marketing activity, the most probably the cost driver will be the turnover or the revenue?
Good question, right? In some marketing activities, I would say yes. But advertising and promotion, I would say dangerous. Okay, let me tell you why. Okay? By dividing by revenue, what we are saying is that revenue causes advertising. Think about that. But we know that advertising causes revenue. So 90% of accountants use revenue, and 100% of marketers accept revenue, but they've got the relationship back to front. Okay? By dividing by revenue, you're saying that that revenue is causing advertising. So where promotion is concerned, I'll be leading on to this, when you do marketing, you cannot use revenue, or you shouldn't use revenue, although many people do so. In fact, it reminds me of an Irish joke. Now, in Australia, I'm not supposed to tell Irish jokes because they indicate that Irishman is not very intelligent. Because there are lots of Irish people in my classes in Australia, but I don't think anyone here is from Ireland. Is it? Okay, so I can tell Irish.
Go ahead. Huh? Go ahead.
In Lebanon, I make the Irishman a Syrian. Okay? Because if there's a Syrian in the class, I don't do that. Because the Lebanese think of Syrians like that, I don't know why. Okay. Anyway, this was an Australian, American, and Irishman. They were discussing their marriage problems. And the American said, you know, my wife is having an affair with a doctor. So they said, how do you know it's a doctor? They didn't question about the affair, they said, how do you know it's a doctor? He said, I was looking for my shoes under the bed when I found a stethoscope. Okay, so stethoscope means doctor, right? Then the Australian said, I'm having the same problem with, and my wife's having an affair with an accountant. So how do you know it's an accountant? Because I looked under the bed for my shoes and I found all this CMA material and everything under the bed, okay? So then the Irishman is getting nervous and he said, now I understand. My wife is having an affair with a horse. Okay, the horse. Why do you say that? He said, I looked under the bed and I found the jockey there, the one who rides the horse. Okay, so the poor guy had got the relationship back to front. By seeing the jockey, he thought the horse was having the affair. Okay, so that is the same as allocating using revenue. Okay, you get the relationship back to front. So there's a strong argument that such costs should not be allocated at all. And this will be discussed later under direct segmental costing. So there is going to be costs that you cannot allocate because you cannot find a cost driver, or the cost driver is not logical. Okay, so we come to that later. Yes?
Coming back to the marketing and the
yes.
Based on the
total revenue. No, I'm not saying to use total revenue. I said not to use. Not to use. Don't use it. No. Many people use it, but I am saying not to use it because it's giving the relationship back to front. Yeah. So I will show you, I will do direct segment costing, how to do that. Okay. But you shouldn't use revenue. Okay. So let us look at cost drivers now, the suitability of cost drivers. These must fulfill certain demands. They must be measurable, controllable. You see, it must be measurable, because if you can't measure, you can't use it as cost driver. Remember I said, you know, John, can you take this and put it somewhere else? Cannot be used because you can't measure it. It should be controllable, because if you can't control a cost driver, that means you can't control costs. It should be acceptable to those in the organization. People should understand it. Okay, now when I did the ABC study at Telstra in Australia, a member of the trade union was part of the ABC team and had to sign off on cost drivers, saying that yes, we accept it as being a logical cost driver for the organization. It must be linkable to the cost object. We had to find the link. If you can't, you can't use it. And finally, it must be simple. Don't use complicated cost drivers. Don't use a cost driver that has distance, value, time, all of that. These complicated mathematical cost drivers simply are, first of all, not simple, and then no one can understand them, so it will not be acceptable. So even if it's a compromise, use a simple cost driver. So remember, you must, all these five must be fulfilled. If one of these are not there, you cannot use it as a cost driver. So compromise is required. Given above demand, the true cost driver may be omitted. The solution must be a compromise in which the best available driver is chosen. Okay, so let's look at the three basic cost driver categories. First is volume cost. So certainly, volume is a cost driver, just like in the traditional, time and money would be cost drivers. Things such as labor hours, cost, machine hours, material volume, these are acceptable cost drivers. Then you have introduction costs, a separate category, introduction costs. These are the costs that are driven by product development, product introductions, changes in the product. Now you saw that yesterday. The moment you got A, it took a lot of time for you to get A. Then when I introduced B, it was a little bit more complication and problems. Okay, these are introduction costs. Some introduction costs are easy to identify, like R&D. Others are more difficult, the extra scrap generated by a production crew that is unfamiliar with the new product. So all that paper you found in the middle of your table is that production cost. Okay. And then there's everything else. Everything that is not volume and not introduction is classified as structural. All other costs. The variety of cost drivers are simply categorized as structural, for example, the number of parts, the number of customers, the number of manufacturing orders, purchase orders, processes, operations, all of these are structural. There's virtually no limit to the number of cost drivers that can be identified in this group. Often they are linked to each other in a complex pattern, but importantly, do not have the complex pattern as a cost driver, because it will lose the simplicity. Okay, so let's look at an example now. Let us say company has a total of 10 million indirect overhead costs to distribute amongst these 100 products. Amongst them are product 1 and 2. On investigation, the following data about the two are revealed. Each of them have 4 parts. In total, all of the products have 400 parts. The number of units manufactured, the number of direct labor hours, therefore direct labor hours per unit is about 0.08 on average, but these two take about 0.1. And number of orders 125 and 40 in total for all the products, 1,000. So we are looking at just 2 products of the number of products that are available throughout. Yeah. That's 1 and 2. So traditionally what we would do is, you take the $10 million overhead, divide by the total number of direct labor hours, the direct labor hours over here, 20,000, which means that it's $500 per direct labor hour. Each of the products takes 0.1 of direct labor hour, so each would be $50. So because they have the same time, they are given the same allocation per unit. But when you multiply it by the number of units, of course, the high volume product gets a huge amount of the overhead. Note that the conventional costing scheme, the amount of indirect overhead that is assigned to each unit, is not at all informed by the fact that the volume of product 1 is 25 times larger than product 2. The managers often intuitively feel that this is wrong. A more careful analysis of the overhead will inevitably confirm this intuition. So, as I told you yesterday, the blue pen is our standard product, high volume. We know how to do this, we don't spend very much time on it. All the managers are looking at the new product, the red pen. Okay, so all the costs are really going towards the red pen, but because the high volume, this one gets hit with the cost. Okay, so managers know this is not correct. They know that the blue pen doesn't cost so much, and the red pen is costing a lot, but that's not what the costing system is showing. So the smiling faces, the faces go unsmiling. Okay, so what do we do? Step one, analysis of activities being performed is made by interviewing persons or groups. Each activity linked to the relevant cost driver. So here's an example of a single interview. Just say that the wages cost and other costs, this person is 35,000 in total. Other costs would be like pension fund and all of that over time. Person interviewed says, I do three activities. Two of them are driven by number of orders cost driver, one of them is red labor hours. You can see three activities are now given into two cost driver pools. Okay, 21,000 driven by the number of orders and 14,000 by the number of direct labor hours. So that's a single interview. Like that, we'll interview all, and you find that about 50% of it is volume related, 5 million, 30% manufacturing orders, 3 million, and 20% the number of parts, 2 million. That's all. So then we divide the cost pools by the cost drivers. So that 5 million is divided by 20,000 direct labor hours, that's $250 in direct labor hour. The 3 million manufacturing orders is divided by the number of orders, and the 2 million given by parts is divided by the number of parts. Now we multiply it by the cost drivers for the two products, okay, by the yearly volume. So here you can see the multiply by the labor hours, manufacturing order cost, and parts for each of the products, you will find that the total cost is like this. Divide by the yearly volume of units, and you find that this product one is $40.80. Remember, it was earlier $50, so this was overcosted earlier. And look at that one, a massive $165. Earlier it said 50. Now American consultants call this a big hit from baseball. Big hit. Okay, because once you show this, and this is exactly what I showed in British American Tobacco, you show the cost changing like this, you've got the consulting job. Okay? So look at that. Earlier, because the time was the same allocation was done. This one was overcosted, but that was massively undercosted. And if the revenue is somewhere there, you're getting a loss for every product that you sell. Because it gives you very good insight when you do this sort of thing. Okay, so the advantages and limitations. Key advantages is a restored relation between the cause and effect and a more optimal level of accuracy. Yes?
About the allocation cost. Now
yes?
For example, we assume 100 X. For example, the total allocation cost.
Okay, and this is an important thing to realize. Cost allocation does not reduce the cost. Okay, it simply tells you where the costs are being incurred. But as a company, if you want to reduce costs, you have to do some other value engineering.
Exactly.
That's all. Allocation only shows you actually where the costs are being incurred. Okay, this reminds me of a person called Yogi Berra, who was an American baseballer. Okay, he was a big man. And he ordered a pizza, and the man said, you have cut it into 4 slices or 8 slices. He said, I'm very hungry today, so cut it into 8 slices. Now what do you think? It's the same pizza. Doesn't matter how you cut it, it's the same pizza, right? So allocation only allocates the thing differently, cuts the thing differently, but it's still one company cost. So don't expect cost to change. This is not a cost reduction exercise. That is target costing. This is a cost allocation exercise to see what is actually costing us money or not. So thank you for that point.
So that would show that the mobility of each department is
correct. So in your case, if it's a maintenance company, the total expenses will be divided amongst engine, components, and so on, and then put down to the various area that you're going to charge money for. Okay, so it's a restored relation between the cause and effect and a more optimal level of accuracy. This means that the cost system starts in the correct signals to all levels of the firm. A more detailed and relevant cost measurement. The errors in traditional accounting are sometimes very large. You can see in that example I gave you, and can seriously distort decision making. With a well-designed ABC system, it is possible to monitor and analyze individual product costs in detail. And the possibility to extend the cost measurement to customers and other objects. So we are going to show you in the next topic and after the topic that follows that we can extend this to customer profitability and then even to white collar departments like accounting and legal affairs and so on that you all are working in. And finally, a greatly improved potential for measuring and improving the efficiency of the day-to-day activities. The interviewing process itself is worthwhile. There are lots of things up to light when you're doing an interview. Okay, note that, of course, none of this is to say that the results produced by ABC are mathematically exact. No costing method can encompass that objective or rely on a model of reality, and every model is an approximation. But activity-based models provide answers that are more logical than those provided by traditional costing. Okay, what are the limitations? Activity-based costing provides considerable advantage to some firms, but only small gains to others. In firms with a simple structure and with greater part of their cost volume related, the benefits will be small. Thus, there are firms for which the undertaking of implementing ABC is not worthwhile. And sometimes it's the firm, but sometimes it can be a division of a firm. Now, I can give you two examples. One is that I, very early in the piece when ABC came out, I was in a seminar and I was following the person from Coca-Cola in the Melbourne office of Coca-Cola. And that person got up before me and said, we tried ABC in our manufacturing plant and it was didn't work. Cost didn't change very much. It was a waste of effort. So I had to get up after him to tell how good ABC was. Okay, so luckily I was after him because I said, look, Coca-Cola is a very large company, one of the largest companies in the world, but its manufacturing division is not complex. Basically, they make a product with 99% water. Okay, it's not very complex. A can of Coca-Cola is not even as complex as this little whiteboard marker. Okay, so in manufacturing, of course, the products won't move because it's all related to volume. But in marketing, the distribution, that is quite different. Coca-Cola has so many different types of customers: retailers, wholesalers, restaurants, aircraft, airlines. You name it. So ABC in the distribution division would have shown much different numbers to their production area. Another example is Proton. When Proton first came, they approached me to do an ABC study in their company. And I said, how many products do you have? They said, only one, the Proton Saga. I said, you don't need ABC because every single cost is direct. There's only one product. But then many years later, they came to me and I asked them then, hey, how about ABC for Proton? They said, no, Proton doesn't need ABC. But by that time, they had about five cars, the Proton Saga, Veera, Pradhana, and like that, right? So they were still allocating based on volume when their business had become more complex. So you got to remember that less complex the organization, you don't need ABC. In the 2 decades that ABC has been used, it's been around for a long time, 2 decades, 20 years or more, there has been criticism from academic researchers and companies both regarding the theory of ABC and the benefits of it. In fact, the father of ABC, Robert Kaplan himself, has come out against ABC. Okay? And I'll talk more about that later. He has said that ABC, all these interviews, are very difficult to maintain and sustain. And so he has come up with a new version of ABC called TDABC, time-driven ABC, which I have given some papers in your notes about that. But I've also shown you that the time-driven ABC is theoretically inferior, and also that it doesn't, in its extreme form, it is just the same as traditional costing. Okay. Another issue is the implementation of ABC in USA, UK, and New Zealand, and Canada, and Australia, so all Western countries, up to the year 2011 has been around 15 to 20% amongst complex manufacturing companies, with many not sustaining. So many of them are not sustaining. So we have to find out why they're trying ABC and they're giving up. Now, it's, this figure is quite interesting. In about 1995, it was about 15%. In about 2000, it went up to about 30%. And now it has fallen to 15 to 20% in 2011. So the amount of ABC implementation went up and has now fallen. Okay? So many not sustaining. And you have to ask why. I mean, if it is so good, why are companies not doing it? So I'm going to talk a little bit about Kaplan and ABC later. Okay? But we'll talk about them under implementation. Yes?
I'm just wondering, what about the other 80%? What they are using to allocate their cost?
This?
Traditional.
Normal.
Yeah, which is giving
but
all sorts of
this wrong information. This is enough to give them the cost of the product?
No, it's giving all wrong information, but they're still doing it. So when we are looking at implementation tomorrow, we will see why this is the case. Okay, it is really concerning. So all our so-called cost accountants are giving their management team wrong information. Okay?
But. To be honest, really, the cost driver, building the cost driver based on the interviews, I was working in manufacturing somehow maybe 5 years, 6 years ago. It's difficult, and they are not giving you the correct information, and they have to trust you after several years. Maybe you stay 2-3 years, you can get the information after that. So you have to build the relation, and to come as a consultant or stay 2-3 months in the company to get the information from the people, especially with the complex and the huge production, it's very difficult. I'm speaking about the Middle East here, and it's a drawback, I think, in the ABC.
I know. So the two issues you mentioned. One is the difficulty of collecting the information and keeping it up to date, okay, and the accuracy of the information. Let me talk about the accuracy first. I am not worried if the information is even 50% wrong. Even 50% wrong is better than having a single cost. Okay, so you will see as I go on that no point having auditor level accuracy. You can have reasonably good cost driver information without that. It's still better than going to the traditional. Point number two is about the interviews. Now that is exactly what Kaplan is saying in his paper. He's saying, don't ask everyone about interview because it's too difficult, cannot sustain. Ask the managers. That's why it's called time-driven ABC. Ask the manager, look, in your team, how long do you take? Get the manager's opinion and use it for ABC rather than interviewing everyone.
Does the manager know? Does the manager know? Is he on the floor?
Yeah, but
sometimes
he says
there is a hidden issue.
Okay, but I will show you. So he essentially converts everything into time. Okay, so no more number of setups, no more number of switches and so on. Everything is converted to time based on the manager's view. So I have done a paper which has just been published about maybe 5 months ago, and Captain probably doesn't like it, but he's not mentioned, where I show you that in fact, taking time-driven ABC to extreme is just the same as traditional, okay, which is based on time. So there is no perfect answer, and I will give you how companies have overcome this problem of trying to get accurate information all the time. Okay, so under implementation, I'll cover that. But very good 2 points raised. Okay, so now let's move on to, I like this now. This is the sort of discussion we need to have. We have now the time to do it. Okay, so let's look at segmental direct costing. Remember I talked about the advertising problem? That sometimes you can't find a cost driver. Well, this is mainly to do with marketing costs, but there could be other costs as well. For example, the managing director's salary. How can you allocate your managing director's or your chairman's salary to the products? Can you find a cost driver? Number of lunches? Number of golf games? You can't, right? So how do you allocate that cost?
Number of drinks.
Number of drinks, yes. But how many drinks to the product? You can't, right? So there are costs that you cannot find a cost driver. They cannot be objectively allocable to products and customers. So traditionally, as I told you, we have used arbitrary allocations. So we talked about percentage revenue, but I told you that in advertising, that means that revenue is causing advertising, which is like the Irishman. In other instances, the cause-effect relationship may be questionable. Take, for example, a salesman who makes sales calls. Okay, so you might think, look, the salesman's salary can be divided by the number of sales calls. But then, in the first sales call, he doesn't sell anything. The second one, he sells a product. Third one, he collects information about a competitor's product, market intelligence. So you can see that it may not reflect the true nature of his or her job. So this causes problems of functional managers who need unambiguous information for decision making. Thus, the method of cost, direct costing at differing segmental levels has been suggested. So this is a segmental level of an organization. You will see that in this particular example, there's a corporate level, divisional level, territorial, market, product, customer. Some of you might have the market level above the divisional level or the product level above the market level. However, everyone will have the corporate level at the top. Okay, so let us say that you are, this advertisement is for a single, let us take a calculated section, a single business calculator at a good price, this advertisement here. Then of course that cost is direct to that level. But if this one here is all the company's calculators, scientific and business calculators, then what we are saying is you can't bring it as a direct cost here or here, but at the calculator level, you can put it as a direct cost. Okay? And if it's the managing director salary, it becomes direct only at the corporate level. So this is the model that we are going to use. Now you will notice in your notes, I think, you have a slightly different model with an extra. Okay. So what you all have in your notes is this one here. Okay, you have up to this section, the financial accounting, right? Up to the stage on allocation, which is not a problem. But from here to here, we are going to use a model like this. Okay, now in the model that you have at the bottom of that page, you'll find that there's an extra question over here. But initially, let us take the purest form without that question. So I'll explain that in a minute. Okay, so let's put it down on paper as well. We're taking a cost, revenue, or investment item. And what you're saying is, go to the lowest level of the organization and ask the question, is it direct? Is it direct? Is it a direct cost? If the answer is yes, we use a term called attach, cost attachment. If the answer is yes. If the answer is no, now you have a little box here, but I won't use it initially, then what you'll do is, you will go to next higher level, and come here. Okay? So this way, in the case of the calculators, you go to the lowest level, is it direct? No. Is it direct? No. Is it direct? Yes. Managing director salary, is it direct? No, 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 yes. So all costs become direct at some level. Okay? So this model is really good because it does not have any allocation at all. It just assigns a cost, attaches a cost at the level at which it becomes a direct cost, not a shared cost. But the problem with this method is that all the arrows are pointing upwards. The costs are going up the organization. When we want the cost to come as much down the organization, so we can do things like pricing and product costing. So because of that, we ask this second question. Okay. Is it direct? If the answer is no, we ask a second question. Is there a cost driver available? Is there a cost driver available? If the answer is yes, we now can allocate. If the answer is still no, like the managing director salary, then we have to go to the higher level. Okay? So is cost driver available? Must fulfill the four conditions, the five conditions. It must be measurable, controllable, acceptable, linkable, and simple. So it has to fulfill all those conditions to be considered a cost driver. Any of those are missing, you have to go to the next level. Now today's software on ABC has this incorporated in it. This is called hierarchical cost attachment and allocation. Hierarchical. The only area that I found very difficult to do this was in telecommunications. The reason is this thing called network management that runs across all the levels of the organization in telecoms. Some of you who are in telecoms know this, right? It just cuts across every level, so you don't know exactly where to put it, but there are methods of doing it. But other than telecoms, I haven't come across any other organization that you can't find a reasonable cost structure. Segmental levels like this. Okay, so the ultimate result would be numbers like this. Now, later on when you're doing marketing, you'll be seeing how these numbers all come. So you can see there is a product level and there is a segmental level, the next higher level. Now, please don't think that these are under product C. These are at the next level. I have not just done another column for it. So you will later see product contribution level, segment contribution level, and so on, this sort of reporting format when we are looking at marketing. Okay, now where does ABC fit into the greater scheme of things? Very many people, I've heard academics saying this, that ABC is a new costing system. It is not. It is a cost allocation system. It's not a costing system. So I did some years ago, I had an assignment that I gave to one of my honor students, an Indian. And he did the assignment. He didn't answer the question in the assignment, but he came up with this particular model. And I had to actually give him very low mark for the assignment, but I told him, look, your paper is so good, let us do a joint paper with this. And we did a paper and it was published. Okay, he went on to be the head of the of research for both the CPAs and the chartered accountants in Australia. And today he's in charge of all of the insurance policy in Australia. Okay, Rohit Sharma. But this particular model really is the essence of what costing is about and where ABC stands. So you can see it's a very, very clear sequence. Now the paper itself, I think, is in your readings, okay? What is the costing method that you're using? Are you using job order costing, which you saw yesterday, process costing, or backfest costing, or some sort of combination? You saw backfest costing, wait until the product is sold, and flush the costs out. What type of costs are we using? Are we using actual costs? So we are not doing anything beforehand, but just waiting for the actual results? Are we using normal costing? Normal costing is where your material and labor is at actual, but your overhead only is on a standard cost basis. Or are you using full standard costing, which is material, labor, and overhead at standards, predetermined standards? How do you treat your overheads? Are you using full absorption costing, where all costs are incorporated? Or are you using variable costing, which is only your variable costs, or some sort of combination? It's in the fourth question, how do you allocate your costs? Do you not do any allocation at all, which is direct costing? Remember, without that extra question. Do you use volume-based, which is, of course, this traditional one, volume-based? Now we come to activity-based. Okay, this model here, activity-based model here. Okay, that is only the fourth thing that you're going to think about. There are others, throughput-based, or companies that are very, very heavy into machinery, how products go through various machines. You look at throughput as an allocation base. Do you use life cycle, where you take the entire life of the product and allocate costs along the whole life, or some sort of combination? So you can see it's in the fourth question. But it goes on. How do you control costs? Do you use budgetary controls? Do you use your budget, which is what we saw earlier? Budgetary control. Do you use activity-based management? That is, use activities and cost drivers as a budget. That's what we're going to do in the last topic today. Zero-based budgeting and program budgeting systems that are often used in government, or do you use target costing to control costs before the launch of the product? So you can see we've done target costing now. How do you make decisions? Do you use relevant costing? Relevant costing is only the cost that is differing between alternatives that you use to make a decision. Marginal costing is your variable costing. Capital budgeting is when you have more than one period and you have to use discount rates to look at your decision. And that capital budgeting will be used in the second course to do something called strategic value analysis, where we are going to value the whole company using capital budgeting techniques. And how do you evaluate performance? You can see here, performance evaluation. Okay? Do you use contribution margins, net profit, return on investment? You're going to come across something called EVA, economic value added or residual income, net present value, strategic value, and so on. So you can see that this is really how an accounting book should be written, and if I have the time, I'll write a book like this, where we start with the costing method and the chapters will follow this sequence. These days I find cost accounting books starting with something like variable costing and then moving on to this in the third chapter and then down to here, and it's quite confusing for students. This is a very, very neat approach of how to understand costing. Any questions? Okay, so it's a very useful way of looking at it.